New at 9, Governor Jan Brewer is just above failing when it comes to managing Arizona's finances. That's according to a new report from the Cato Institute.
New York is open for business. You've seen it in the commercials, but a Washington think tank begs to differ.
The Cato Institute gave Cuomo a D in its annual fiscal report card for its tax and spending policies over the past 2 years.
The libertarian think tank, the Cato Institute, took Haslam to task for a spike in the state hospital tax.
This week, the Cato Institute came out with this study where they rated the governors of the 50 states as they do every 2 years. This is the first time that they've rated governors while Tom Corbett was in office. And what's very interesting, Rob, is he got one of the top grades in the country, one of only four governors to get a solid A.
I actually do support a VAC a little bit. If it's very small, of course, by the end of our lives, it'll be 100% tax probably. But you capture a lot of the economy that's underground, right? The cash economies.
No,
drug dealers aren't going to pay taxes, but they're going to buy stuff, Chris.
That's not true. Actually, in Europe, VAT evasion is a huge problem. European countries spend an enormous amount of time trying to catch VAT thieves and people who avoid the VAT. It's really not a good idea. Most politicians, unfortunately, are really not serious about this problem. I mean, you just had Senator Harry Reid, for example. The first thing he said after the election was he wasn't going to cut Social Security at all. Social Security is the single largest federal program, and spending is out of control. So I don't think he's being serious. I think what Congress is going to do in the next few weeks is they're going to kick the can ahead for 6 months.
You're going to have to grab the middle class by the throat and choke them, because there aren't enough rich people to finance big bloated government. And that's why, you know, I'm standing in London. The reason that they have these big value-added taxes and very high social insurance taxes is the only way you can finance a welfare state is by squeezing the middle class. Now, that's going to be bad for the economy, bad for those taxpayers, just like taxing the rich is bad for the economy.
So you think, Dan, the answer is 100% cut spending? Even though the roads are a billion years old, light poles are falling over if you blow on them, right? And no airline can ever leave any airport on time.
Hey, those are functions of the state and local governments. One of the reasons we're so screwed up in this country, you see it in New Jersey and New York. Everyone waits for the federal government to do things, and the federal government is probably the most incompetent institution on the face of the planet.
Is there any hope that the SEC might bring this market sort of back to the people and make it a more democratic market and sort of keep it out of the hands of big money and big banks?
Quite frankly, I see very little hope in that, because, again, she's going to bring a prosecutor's approach to this. You know, I think if you asked her, I mean, it'll be interesting. I certainly hope the Senate asked her to explain Reg M&S to them, because it's not clear to me that she has any understanding of the market structure issues. And I think much of the enforcement, rather than on Wall Street, will be on hedge funds, will be on insider trading. And again, these things are illegal, these things are important, but again, that's not what caused the crisis.
If you want to grow family wealth and family income over the long run, the way to do it is you have to make labor more productive. That's what drives wages, that's what drives income. And so I worry that we got into a series of essentially asset bubbles. We ran up house prices, now the Fed and others are trying to run up stock prices. And again, house prices don't make anybody more productive. They don't raise your wages in the long run. And ultimately, housing is consumption. It's where you live. I think policies that try to make housing a great investment and try to make it consumption at the same time are in conflict.
The problem was not deregulation here. The problem was that we had a crisis caused by a massive industry-wide misinvestment in real estate, and that was a direct result of government policies.
John Allison, he is the president and CEO of the Cato Institute and the author of a new book, The Financial Crisis and the Free Market Cure.
One reason I wrote the book is so much has been written about the financial crisis is just not true. You know, I have the opportunity. I was CEO of BB&T 20 years. I was in the banking business for 38 years. I met with, Larry and I were just talking about, we met years ago. I knew Bernanke, knew Greenspan, knew all the CEOs of large financial institutions. And this is, I believe, the first book that actually tells people what really happened in the total context, going back to the early 70s, working through what happened with the Community Reinvestment Act, Freddie and Fannie, the impact on decision makers. A lot of the books written by economists that don't really understand what the impact of regulations have on people trying to make decisions. Mm-hmm. If somebody threatens to put you in jail or close your bank down, you're going to do things that you may have a lot of discomfort with. The government spending destroys wealth and well-being. The case is made, and the United States government spending has been rising as a percentage of gross national product radically over the last 12, 15 years, and we're closing in on Europe with blinding speed, and the consequences are reduced growth and reduced well-being, and that's what the conversation ought to be about.
So would you
you expect to see interest rates spiking quickly anytime soon as a result of you know, a change in attitude toward the debt of the U.S.?
I don't think it's going to happen very soon. I think it's going to happen if over the next 4 years we don't exercise radically better fiscal discipline than we have. If you run the mathematics for the United States, if we continue the way we're going, in 15 or 20 years, we do go bankrupt. That's not politics. That's just mathematics. And the question is, are we going to change direction?
But also, social issues can be divisive. And that's why you build a... We have seen this. Candidates on, from the GOP side have been more successful when they stick to the important economic issue.
But Emily,
yeah. Romney was a better economic candidate. I mean, if we're going to say the economy, if everyone, we thought the conventional wisdom, that the economy was
How many GOP senators, if they hadn't stuck their foot in their mouths on divisive social issues, would be U.S. senators today?
What we're talking about here is not caused by the constitutional way of electing the president, the so-called Electoral College. It's because the state legislatures, almost all of them, use what is called the winner-take-all system. That is, the reason that Republicans don't get electoral votes in California and vice versa for Democrats in Texas is because those state legislatures have decided to award all of the electoral votes to the person who gets the most electoral votes. It's nothing about the Constitution. These state legislatures, if they wanted to hear their voters, they could change this if they wanted to, but only two have done so.
Right. If jobs were all we cared about, you know, 130 years ago, there were a lot more people employed in the agricultural sector. You know, if we were only worried about jobs, we would ban mechanized tractors and whatnot and have people cut wheat by hand. The fact that there are fewer people employed in the defense industry over the last few years, defense contractors have been making more money and cutting employment. Why? Because they're becoming more efficient. We like this when this happens in every other sector. But in the defense business, for some reason, we think we want the Pentagon to be a jobs program. And I think most Americans recognize that's not what it should be doing.
Just today it was released that Ambassador Chris Stevens, the day he was killed, he sent a cable to Secretary of State Clinton warning about the expanding Islamist influence in the region and also warning that U.S. officials were going to be in jeopardy because the local militias were going to pull back their security for those officials. And I think those claims and others like them and the attacks that we've been seeing over the past year really fly in the face of what the administration has been telling us, which is that, you know, the intervention has been a resounding success. President Obama wants a managed transition out of Afghanistan by 2014. This requires an army and police, an indigenous army and police that can stand up as we stand down. If these joint operations have a systemic problem in terms of Afghan forces turning their guns on their American counterparts, that's a problem with the integrity of the mission, and it really is the greatest threat to the mission right now.
I am a libertarian, but I think you're being too individualist about this, right? The problem in the 60s and 70s when the FBI was spying on the sexual activities of Martin Luther King and other civil rights activists, anti-war activists, members of the Supreme Court, members of executive agencies, was not just that it was individually embarrassing for them and a violation of their, you know, personal dignity. It's that politically, in a democracy, the kind of power that comes with that information is dangerous beyond, whatever indignity is visited upon the individual.
Trevor Burrus with the Libertarian Cato Institute has researched gun laws and gun violence across the country and doesn't believe banning assault weapons will have much impact at all in reducing crime.
No, it will make a big difference. The assault weapons ban between 1994 and 2004 did almost nothing to curb gun violence in this country, and it's not surprising because the weapons that were banned are almost never used in gun crimes, comparatively speaking.
I welcome a different states trying to address their particular problems. Certainly, Montana faces different issues than New York does. I don't think there's a one-size-fits-all solution for the entire country.
Did the government effectively save hundreds of thousands of jobs with that move?
I think they probably deferred that decision for a few years. What they've done is they helped preserve jobs at GM in the short run, but when the next recession hits, the burden is going to be on all of the car companies again. There is overcapacity in this industry. We need to thin the herd. And I think GM was a good candidate for that at the time, but the administration, by giving them a lifeline, has deferred that past the most recent election. And when the next crisis hits, we'll see who sinks and who swims.
President Obama says he'll stimulate the economy
with green jobs. Mitt Romney says with defense jobs.
Right. They both subscribe to this. Absolutely. Same principle. They just spend it on different programs because their priorities are different, or they think their voters' priorities are different. But it's the same concept. If the government gets involved and spends money, then it will create jobs. But it's the same concept as when you smash something. When you take that money, the government takes it from other uses. It takes it from taxpayers, businesses, consumers. It just redistributes resources, doesn't create anything.
I think Obama is a classic example of this cult of the presidency, but the idea that the president or any politician can just fix all the problems in society, that there's some kind of magic there, doesn't start with Obama. It goes a long way back, and it is this attitude that we should get rid of racism. The president should do that. He should stop the rise of the oceans. He should get everybody a house. You know, I saw an interview once with teenagers where they said, actually, it may have been preteens, who said things like, he should get everybody a house. Well, kids, that's understandable. They see people without houses, they say the government should give everybody a house. Adults are supposed to understand that there are costs and trade-offs and incentives, and that if you start trying to do these things, there are a lot of unintended consequences, and the government cannot just magically eradicate racism, poverty, homelessness.